today we start looking at principalities and other spirits. Principalities, powers, rulers of darkness of this world, and so on and so forth. And how do you deal with the question of principalities? What are principalities and powers? The word principalities and powers occurs about six times in the Bible, and always in the King James Version, it is referred specifically as principalities and powers. But other versions translate it as rulers and authorities, forces and authorities, rulers and powers, and so on and so forth. But in every place where this particular phrase appears, the context always has to do with the array of evil and malicious spirits that stand against God's work or God's people. You always have to get that in perspective. That stands against God's work or God's people. Let's look at Romans 8, 37 to 39. That is the first mention of that. The first mention of that.
Romans chapter 8, verse 37. No, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord.
The love of God is paramount, and it is two ways. It is God's love flowing to us, and then we reciprocating. And there are times that one will feel not loved, just like in a marriage relationship or friendship or what have you. And sometimes when you face that, it makes you question whether there is some sort of validity in the relationship you're in. Now, the forces that be work out stuff so we can doubt the love of God. And if we don't have time this evening, God willing, next week, we'll look at that. How they are arrayed, how they are structured in order to question our love, not so much even our love for him, but his love for us. And so Paul puts it in the place where it talks about some of those principalities and powers. Their aim, or one of their aims, is to stop us from validating, or if you like, stop us from experiencing that love that comes from him. So Paul puts in a very strong fashion. He said, we are more than conquerors. We are more than conquerors. And he said, I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, you understand, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God. These verses all prove the fact that we are victorious in Christ. And if we are more than conquerors, it means that we can fail. So what happens is that those principalities and powers and all those agents of darkness position themselves to make us fail. And you remember some time ago, I gave a sermon in this church, and I said that your resolve in life is to succeed. It's very paramount. You know, your many talks don't convince your enemy. When you are successful, it silences your enemy. Are you understanding that? The world even understands that. I was reading something about the history of America, and I came across this that really blessed me. And during the Civil War, I think Abraham Lincoln that made that statement. Very powerful. I said, wow, that is scripture. Then he said that whatever is going on in our United States, whatever is going on in all the place from Mississippi up to whatever, he said that One thing that we must understand, my fellow Americans, our resolve is to succeed. I said, wow, that is scripture. Your resolve is to succeed. And so impediments are placed in your way to stop you from being successful. And that is why God had to tell Joshua. He said, don't let this word of the Lord depart out of your mouth. But you meditate on it day and night, that you will be careful to do everything that is written therein. Then you will be successful. Are you understanding that? And he was successful. He led the people of God to the promised land. So the first test that talks about principalities and powers is saying that they can't stop us from loving God. And they cannot stop God's love from reaching us. Because God's love does so many things. One of the things I love about God's love is confidence. Sometimes when I lose confidence and I think about the fact that God loves me, I just sit up. I feel great. Are you understanding that? And I look at it from a physical point of view. Because if you happen to be Cameron's son, or the Queen's son, or some big president's son, are you understanding that this week, somebody was talking to me about how he met the president of Ghana's brother, and this, and the confidence and stuff. I said, yes, that is the way it is. If human beings can be able to set up confidence like that, how much more the creator of the universe? Glory to God. So you must know he loves you. Don't let anything separate that love. Don't let your sickness, that's what he's talking about. Hallelujah. Don't let your poverty, don't let your lack, don't let anything, always have it in your mind, because it is the work of those principalities to do that. The second test we see principalities and powers in is Colossians 1:16.
Colossians chapter 1, verse 16. For in him all things were created, things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or powers or rulers or authorities, all things have been created through him and for him.
Hallelujah. So basically, it's talking about a clear statement that God is the creator and the ruler of all authorities. Whether they submit to him or they rebel against him, he created them. He is all powerful. Whatever power you can think of is beneath God. Hallelujah. And remember, everything that there is by him. He created Satan. His name wasn't Satan. His name was Lucifer. Are you understanding? And he became Satan. All right? And you have to get this right. Because they are under him, he gives us authority to deal with them. We'll come and look at Daniel soon. But this test gives us the understanding that you should not be afraid of any powers that be. Glory to Jesus. Not even human authorities. Bible says honor and respect human authorities. Glory to God. Whether you voted for the prime minister or not, he is your prime minister. You got to honor him. Bible says so. And as a child of God, you got to do that. You may not like his policies. You may not like what he stands for. You may not like who he's funding, who he's not funding. But the Bible demands that as a believer, you have honor and respect for your king. You must honor your pastor. You must honor your father. You must honor your mother. You must honor your mayor. You must honor anybody in authority over you. You must honor them. Yes, you may have problems with Boris Johnson, but he's your mayor. He is your mayor. You've got to honor him. Glory to Jesus. That is what it says. Then let's come to the second, the third reference to principalities, Colossians 2:15.
Colossians chapter 2, verse 15. And having disarmed the powers and authority, he made a public spectacle of them, triumphing over them by the cross.
It says, and having disarmed the powers and principalities. How did he disarm them? I've told you this when I open up this test, but for those of you who are here, let me just go back and give some sort of refresher course of maybe a small synopsis on that. When the devil fell, that is Satan, and all his agents, obviously, there was a vacuum in worship because he was the anointed cherub that covereth. So if you could see the Ark of Covenant, you realize that there are two cherubims, with their feet, their wings like that, that covers. Yes, that was him. It is believed from extensive research that he used to live on earth. And he lived in a place called Eden. And what he would do is that there were some sort of beings that lived here on earth. They were not human beings. We don't know how they looked like. I believe personally that it was those times where dinosaurs and all those things used to live on earth. And he will collect the praises of God to him. So he commutes between earth and wherever heaven is. And the interesting thing is that the Bible teaches very clearly in Isaiah that the day he decided to rebel against God, he said, I will ascend on high. That tells you that he was below the stars. He said that I will exalt my throne. That tells you that he had a throne. And he said that I will rule over the people in the north. That tells you that there were some sort of beings that lived there. And he said that, but you were brought down. And then the whole earth got destroyed. That is what Greek word, the Hebrew word that is there is a very beautiful word. It's called tohu bohu, which means simply that it was aluta. Something actually happened to the earth. And then Bible says that God created another Eden. So he used to live in Eden, and then this new Eden that was created was not given to him. It was given to man, you and I. So now we then became, or we replaced him, if you like. That is one of the reasons why he's got his eyes on us. And he wants to make sure that we fail, so he can just tell God that you threw me out, and the people you put in place, they also failed. So when the Lord realized that the people he put in place failed, he slaughtered Jesus. So before the foundations of the earth, before Adam and Eve could sin, Jesus had already been slain. Are you understanding that? So basically, now he is an anointed cherub. Now there are three archangels that were in heaven, or that control matters. That is Archangel Lucifer, Archangel Michael, and Archangel Gabriel. And so he took one third of the whole heavenly host with him. Those became the fallen angels we see. And then the people that he used to control became the demons we see, because those demons need bodies in order to function and operate. And so Isaiah gives us another insight into what happens in heaven. Because remember, according to Daniel 10, Daniel was praying. And then he said that this thing going on, God must intervene. So he goes into his closet, and for 21 days he was been praying, nothing was happening. On the 21st day, an angel comes down, and he tells Daniel that the day you started praying, God answered your prayer. He dispatched me to come and bring you the answer. But the prince of Persia, in other words, what we're studying right now, the principality, we'll come to that in detail in a minute, but the principality of Persia withstood me. I couldn't stand him. Even though I'm a righteous angel, and the principality was a fallen angel, because the order of ranking, he is of a higher ranking than I am. So we couldn't. And the Lord had to send another angel. The Bible says that the archangel Michael, who came and sorted the problem out. So God sat there and he said, now I have already slain my son in the spirit. But somebody needs to go down there and sort the salvation issue out once and for all. And so he said, I want to send someone, and who will go? Bible says the whole heavenly host, everybody was quiet. The archangels, everybody was quiet. They were quiet not because they didn't want to obey God, the Father. They were quiet not because they feel like the demands of the Father was too much. They were quiet because the highest ranking angel, which is an archangel, Michael or Gabriel, their ranking was as equal as Lucifer. And therefore, it's going to be messy. So we need somebody who is higher than him in order to deal with him, because you cannot have a corporal give a general instructions. It is not done. Are you understanding that? That's as I said on Sunday, that it is the higher that blesses the lower, not the other way around. It's out of order for you to get up and lay hands on your pastor. Even the sight is sickening. Hallelujah. Amen. So Jesus realized that, come on, Father, you've asked something nobody can do. The only person who is higher than Satan is you and me as your son. And so then he said, send me. I will go. And then he was sent. And then he came and he disarmed them. So he dealt with the principalities. He dealt with the powers. And the final onslaught was the cross. And so in his 3 years ministry, now his 30 years life, now let me just go back again. Now his first 12 years was governmental self-development in word. So by the time he was 12, he knows the Torah. He could recite it. He could just recite it. He could just tell you everything in there. At the 12th year when he went to the synagogue, he was teaching people. People older than him. Because in the Hebraic order, by 12 years old, before you become a son, you must know the word. And these are some of the things we are trying to instill in this church. We are a long way from there, but we'll get there one day. Hallelujah. You must know the word. Glory to God. You must know the word. Our children know how to read physics books and chemistry books and stuff like that. But they don't read the Bible. At a 12-year-old, when you are born, you are a son. I mean, you are a child. As soon as you are 12, you are a son. That's what they have bar mitzvah. So he said, Isaiah says that unto us a child is born, and then a son is given. All right. So now, biblical development, first 12 years, and then he does his bar mitzvah, and then he enters into adulthood. And in between 12 to 30, we didn't hear about him. That was personal development. And then for 3 years, he gives the ministry a shot. In all this time, he was preparing the final onslaught to bring the powers and principalities down. And then finally, he goes to the cross. He turns to the thief, I think was it on his left or his right, and he says to the thief, that tonight you will be with me in paradiso. You'll be with me in paradiso, in paradise. I am going to change something because for the first time, a new waiting area is going to be created. We are going to create a VIP lounge before you board the flight. Are you understanding that? So every believer that dies before the rapture can have a place. And he said, because you have believed in me, you're going to be with me over there. And so he goes in there, and then on the final day, Bible says first, he goes and preaches to all those who have died. From Adam. And I told you about Hades and Sheol. And he led captivity captive. He led them in his trail. Moved them from Hades into paradise. And then when he has done that, he now walks to Satan. And he said, I need the keys now. I need the keys. Principalities and powers, no more authority. I need the keys. And he collected the keys. The Bible says that when he had come out of the grave, and the grave could not hold him, and the apostles came along him, he told the apostles, now the keys have been given me. He said, the keys to unlock heaven, earth, and under the earth. And I give the keys to you. So now he has disarmed principalities and powers. Now I'll show you in a minute that the only reason why we feel the effects of principalities and powers is because the church sleeps. And it is like a balance. As soon as the church goes to sleep, the activities of principalities and powers rises. As soon as the church wakes up, the activities of principalities and powers go down. And that is why seasons change. Because there is a time the activities are so high, don't look at the principalities, look at the church. And I'm going to show you that it is not an individual that does it. Because when it comes to principalities, you cannot pray them. It is the manifold wisdom of the church of God that must be displayed by the church. And I'm going to read that in a minute. So let me just demonstrate this and read that. So this is the church. This is the principalities. The Bible says, according to Chronicles, that if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray, turn away from... You see, then God is not interested in the non-believers. He's interested in the sanctity of his people. And once his people who are called by his name will humble themselves and pray, turn away from their wicked ways and do the right thing, it says the land will be healed. And who controls the land is the principality. Hallelujah. Yeah. It's the principality that controls the land. So the more powerful the church becomes, then because the matter of fact is that God has disarmed, Jesus has disarmed the powers and all those principalities and so on and so forth. Let's take the next reference, Ephesians 3:10.
Ephesians chapter 3, verse 10.
10 and 11, yeah. Mm-hmm.
His intent was that now, through the church, the manifold wisdom of God should be made known to the rulers and authorities in the heavenly realms, according to his eternal purpose that he has accomplished in Christ Jesus our Lord.
What was it? He disarmed them with an intent. He said, why? That through the word, I didn't hear you, through the word, are we awake? Through the word, let me say it, through the word, is it through Shadrach? Is it through Dorothy? Is it through Patrick? Is it through Joyce? Is it through the word, the church? You don't want to miss Sunday because we're looking at the coat of many colors, what it stood for. And that is the problem the church has, and the devil loves it, that the church can be tagged a black church. It can be tagged a Ghanaian church, a Nigerian church. The church can be tagged women's church, men church. The church can be tagged rich people's church, poor people's church. The church can be tagged Zimbabwe church. That is what the devil likes. And we have all played into it. The fact that the pastor is from Nigeria doesn't make the church a Nigerian church. Or the pastor is from Ghana or Zimbabwe or whatever, South Africa doesn't make a South African church. If division can be established, then the power of the church will go down. He said it is through the church. That was his intent. So there are different levels of warfare, as I said when I opened this teaching. There are different levels of warfare. There are certain warfares you fight differently. For instance, if you are fighting a warfare of poverty, you don't fight with tongues. You fight with what? Giving. Are you understanding that? There are certain warfare you fight with love. Certain warfare you don't fight by saying, but you just speak the truth. And then that shames the devil. Are you understanding that? But this kind of warfare, dealing with the principalities, is not in the power of Shadrach. It's the church must come together. Read it again, please.
Ephesians 3, verse 10. His intent was that now, through the church, the
manifold... Not tomorrow, is that what? Now.
Yeah.
Through the word...
Through the church, the manifold wisdom of God should be made known to the rulers and authorities in the heavenly realms.
That's right. It must be made known to them. So, example, we are coming to Welling, and we know that in the whole Europe, I'm not saying it is so, I'm just making an example. This is abortion headquarters, or witchcraft headquarters. Or this is a place where some kind of demonic thing is really. When the church moves in, the church must now announce to the principality in that jurisdiction that we have come. And we are here to stay. And therefore, your activity that has labeled this area as high prostitution area, that has labeled this area as drug area, that has labeled this area as teenage pregnancy area, that has labeled this area that nobody prospers here. We want you to know the manifold wisdom of God. We dethrone you. And it must be the churches coming together and declaring that. And when that happens, that is it. That is why Esther, when he realized that the issue he was dealing with was a principality issue, not an individual issue. So he told the whole church, in those days that Israel was the church. He said, let the whole church fast. And listen to this. Let children fast. We are not talking about PC here. We're not talking about Child Protection Agency. Let children, let even cats and dogs fast. He said, if I perish, I perish. It is an issue of national proportions. So my prayer alone wouldn't work. I will go and my head will be separated from my body. But if the church come together, and the church being Israel, and they say everybody fasted, The fly ceiling fasted. Everybody. And she took that step of faith because she understood that the manifold wisdom of God through the church is being made to the principalities. So you see, the principalities, they control the kings. And they make the kings make decisions based on their wicked agenda. So a lot of times we sit there, we're blaming Cameron, we're blaming Mahama, we're blaming Jonathan Goodluck, we're blaming Zuma, we're blaming Mugabe, we're blaming... No! The church should stop talking and get on its knees. Some of these guys, they don't even know what they're doing. You know, the reasoning goes off. Can you imagine? Look at the detectors. You look at every detector the way they end. Somebody should sit and say that if detectors end this way, I shouldn't be a detector. But then the spirit takes over them. And they really don't know what they're doing. Because the church is not praying and complaining. We are divisive over little things on doctrine. Are you understanding that? He prayed that we can drink wine. He prayed that we couldn't drink wine. He said that we can do this. He said women can wear skirts. He said well, women have to wear trousers. He said that women can do their hair, pompadour. And he said that well, they cannot take the pompadour out. He said, I mean, come on, nonsense. You'll be amazed. You'll be amazed what makes people even break up from churches. Are you understanding that? Why do you have to walk to the front to give the offering? Why don't you pass a basket around? Huh? What? I mean, pettiness. I went to the church and too many people were speaking Nigerian language, Yoruba. I mean, too many people were speaking Ghanaian language. They were speaking Shona. And they were doing, I mean, so that becomes a problem. And the Lord is saying that through the church. Now finish it.
Verse 11. According to his eternal purpose that he accomplished in Christ Jesus our Lord.
We have to make known to the principalities according to what his eternal purpose. And that is why from time to time we're going to organize nationwide prayer meetings. Nationwide prayer meetings. We're going to organize prayer meetings that bring the whole church together. No division. I don't care whether you are a woman, you are a man. I don't care whether you stand to pray or you kneel down to pray. You prostrate. Hallelujah. Just pray. When we hold hands, we are not holding hands because it feels good, but because it's a prophetic sign of unity. Then the principalities begin to. Before you realize, boom, it's happened to us at least. I can remember twice when that man was home secretary. Michael Howard, you remember? They were about to pass a law and we went into a fast and prayer. Got the whole church. Not only was the law stopped, he was also sacked. No. You don't have to be a president. You don't have to be a prime minister. In your own right, you are. In your closet. You can make decisions in your closet together as a church in order for God's purpose to be fulfilled. Glory to Jesus. That is the way it goes. So we need to understand how principalities operate. Let's take the next verse. Ephesians 6, 12.
Ephesians chapter 6, verse 12. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms.
In this particular text, I like the King James better. It says, the NIV says that struggle, the King James says that we wrestle. All right? And if you've watched a wrestling match before, you know how it is like. When I used to watch wrestling, those days of Van Vader and Undertaker and stuff like that, you see, God delivered me from that. Amen. And you know, I love wrestling so much that I always convince myself that I need to watch it more because the Bible says that we wrestle against flesh and blood. So if I don't watch wrestling, how can I do effective wrestling? But anyway, so so you realize that one opponent pulls the opponent up and then the other opponent pulls the opponent down. So it is like a tussle. That's how wrestling goes. So you have to make sure you put the back of your opponent, your back to the ground. Yeah. Mm-hmm. That is the exact picture. That's why I say struggle is also okay, but the King James gives us a better picture. So what is happening now is that there will be a season that United Kingdom will be great and wonderful because the pastors are praying, because the church is united, because everybody, so the principalities can operate. So we've put their back down. And then instead of keeping their back down, they struggle, you know, if you watch wrestling, when you get to the point, they went, pow, 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 and then they push their legs up immediately, the whole thing turns again. Then, and after 10 years of maybe 15 years, Wigglesworth and all those people, where the church came together and stuff like that, before you realize, the tables turns again. That the church is on its knee. We can't buy church buildings. We cannot have, planning permissions. We cannot, there are more pubs. There was a season in this country where there were more churches than pubs. And every corner you go was a church. That is when that principality of Britannia had its back down. It changed. And you keep doing that until Christ comes. But the point is that we can permanently keep the back of the principality down if the church doesn't lose its power of prayer. So as soon as we keep it down, the church becomes complacent. Either becomes complacent or we don't understand the apostolic. So there are no sons to carry the fire. I was telling somebody yesterday that the problem we have in the body, and forgive me, not because I'm a pastor, but truly, is we have words that describe things that do not make sense to us. So we are not able to walk in the way that we ought to. So if I call, or if I say, not if she is my wife, and I say, my wife, the word my wife alone carries a lot of meaning. It means so many things. If I say it's my friend, it carries so many meanings. How many people understand apostolic? That word just means father. The Catholics understand that. So they don't even use the word apostolic. They use the word father. And the stability and the succession by organization, it is more established than Pentecostals, Methodists, and everything put together. Because once you become a Catholic member, you had apostolic. And that apostolic flows in you. But they don't use the word apostolic. They use a day-to-day language everybody understands. So if you have a father, you grow up to become a true son. And sons follow, and they also take on the view of their father, and they cast it down. In the same way, the church must come to the true apostolic era, where fathers pass the baton to the sons, and sons become fathers, and they also pass it down, so that there will be perpetual flame burning. So that even if you're a doctor, you're a lawyer, you are not even a full-time ministry, you still carry the fire of your father. And wherever you go, you carry that thing over there. And that is why we yo-yo. Because one season, the church is up. The next season is down. For me personally, as a theologian, somebody who studies the Bible, so what really, 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 really made me very sad is the 400 years where the church was so down and principalities took authority. You call it the Dark Ages. The Dark Ages. Because the church went down. 400 years, not about 10 years, 400 years. Evil was reigning because there was nobody to pass the fire down. If Samuel and the rest did not come together and pray for the Azusa Street Revival, which has birthed the Pentecostal, the New Pentecostal, the Charismatic, and the Ultra Charismatic, where will we be? And do we still have sons who will carry this birthing feather, or the church will die at some point? Anglican church is dying. It is said that now only 1% or something like that go to church. Now, if not for the migrant community that have moved into UK, there will be no church. Now, what is so sad, in Devon, and what is their name again? Beatles are more popular than Jesus. And as a matter of fact, unless they are making it up, But what I read the other day is that a survey was made, and some people in Cornwall or Devon, some place like that, some of the children even haven't heard the name Jesus. The work of the principalities and powers. But you know what? We are busy fighting each other. We are busy being very stupid about pettiness when there is great work to be done. This is the work that goes on. Let's take the final test on that, and then we can now look at principalities and the activities properly. Titus 3:1.
Titus chapter 3, verse 1. Remind the people to be subject to rulers and authorities, to be obedient, to be ready to do whatever is good.
You see, now this particular one then is not talking about the spiritual principality. He's talking about the person that spiritual principality submit to. See, now this the irony. Because we don't pray in dealing with the principalities that be, we also find it difficult to submit to physical principalities because we have issues with them. But the truth of the matter is that if we are praying as a church, then they will not rule. It's the church who will be in charge. And so our presidents and prime ministers and so on and so forth will act in accordance to the manifold wisdom of God that has been made known to the principalities, and therefore they cannot work. So it becomes easy for you to do what? Submit to the authority. But we are not able to submit because, you know, fundings are going places that you don't believe they should go, but it's your taxes. So you rise against it instead of pray against it. Decisions are made that are in many ways diametrically opposed to what you believe according to your scriptures and so on and so forth. And that becomes a big problem for you. It's the same thing. But the Bible actually says, and we've read it right now, that we have to submit to authorities. We have to submit. Whether you voted for the prime minister, like I said, or you didn't, he's your prime minister. Whether you voted for the mayor or you didn't, he's your mayor. And the Bible demands that you respect. Once voting is going on, you just have to decide who you want in power. And then once the die has been cast and the winner is come forth, you now accept whatever the result is and you submit to it. But what will make it easy for you to submit is when you are praying and bringing out the powers of principalities and powers down. So these are the five scriptures or six scriptures that directly refers to principalities and powers in the whole of the Bible directly. Now, what we're going to do is now take them piece by piece. We want to look at principalities, the activities, characteristics, and so on and so forth, and then look at powers, who they are, how do they operate in the spirit realm. Then we'll look at rulers of darkness, how they operate, because they are all different sessions of authority they have. The satanic world is well organized. Well organized. Principalities are the top of affairs. Powers next. World rulers of darkness next. And then you have spiritual wickedness in high places. And sometimes I add my own way to say in low places. All right? So that is it. I'm just looking at time and I realize that once I start principalities, I will not be able to knock it off. So I will take this time as questions. If there's any question, let's take it now. God bless you.